All right, so you have a low-yielding well. You don't know what to do, but you've come to the right place because today we're going to discuss a little bit about what happens when your well is not yielding enough water and what are some steps you can take to kind of deal with that situation. So let's go ahead and hop into it. The very first thing we need to kind of figure out and discuss is what is a yield for a well and what does that mean, right? So when you're drilling a well, basically what you're doing is you're putting a straw into the ground. The ground is going to have water. Basically, think about it like a cup. In that cup, you're going to have a pump that pumps the water up out of that straw and into the house. Now, that cup is going to refill as you start pumping water out, but every well is going to refill slightly different from one another, and depending on the geology around you, you might have a higher yield or a lower yield than a neighbor or neighboring property. So when you're trying to determine what the yield is, at least in our state, your state might be slightly different. How we do that is we run it for an extended period of time, and then every 15 minutes we fill up a known volume and time it, right? So in practice, how that ends up going is roughly if you run it for 3 hours to start, up to 6 hours, depending on what the yield is. You'll take a 5 gallon bucket, 1 gallon bucket, whatever, and a stopwatch. And as you're running it, basically you want to run it full bore, no restrictions. So in our state, the way that you do that is you either do that at the wellhead with your own pump or the pump that's connected by pulling the pitless up, or you do it from the manifold at the pressure tank, that little T assembly, right? Big blue thing in your basement, right? You've probably seen it 1.5 million times. So when you're running that test, you run it for at least 3 hours, and every 15 minutes you're gonna fill up a bucket. Now, depending on what that result is, will help you figure out what your yield is. The goal of that test, and the reason you run it for as long as you do, is you wanna drain that cup of water down as far as you can to get it as close to a consistent, steady line, right? So when you do a yield, it should always start high. In our state, you wanna go 8.0 or more. Start high, you'll see it fall down, and then when it plateaus, that means that you've exhausted the reserve. Now, again, the reserve is how much water is just there, right? So once you've exhausted the reserve, now you can start to calculate how much water is coming into the well. Depending on the depth of your well, that could be a quick process, could be a long process, right? If you have a 100-foot well versus a 1,000-foot well, the 100-foot well will hit that plateau far faster than the 1,000-foot well. It also depends on the discharge rate of your pump, right? So let's just say you have a 7 gallon per minute pump versus a 15 gallon per minute pump. One will get there faster than the other. In our state, most of the low yielding well issues that we come across are gonna be on wells that are already developed on existing homes, usually being sold for real estate, or if you're trying to do like an addition, right? So like some counties will make you do a well yield if you're trying to build like a detached unit, or if you're trying to extend the house, just so you can prove that that well is capable of supporting the design of the home that you intend on having on that property. So the reason you're here is your well could not yield enough. In our state, 1.0 is the minimum requirement. Doesn't sound like a lot of water, but depending on what your reserve is and how long it takes to get to that 1.0, you might actually not be in bad shape. You might be able to get a little bit further than what you expect. So for perspective, most shower heads and stuff will put out about 2 gallons a minute. So half cock that shower head and that'll get you roughly what 1 gallon per minute is. And that's gonna be how much water is actively coming and refilling that cup every single minute of every single day of every single year, etc. Now, a well is a natural thing. So sometimes it'll go up and sometimes it'll go down. It really kind of depends on the seasonality of your area. Usually, at least in our area, we'll see a swing of about 0.5 gallon, right? So sometimes you'll see it up about 0.5 and sometimes you'll see it down by about 0.5. It doesn't usually go from like 10.0 to nothing unless there's major geologic activity or major development around your house, right? Let's just say somebody knocks down the farm right behind you, slaps in 60 houses. Well, you know, modern wells are gonna be far deeper than your well most likely is if your house is already existing. So you know your yield is bad. You're less than one. In our state, usually there's three options for what you can try and do, and it really kind of depends on what your purpose is. The first option, which is just kind of like a temporary thing, it will solve your issue of running out of water, but you will run into issues such as real estate transfer down the road, especially in Baltimore County. The first option is storage, right? So what you'll do is you'll put 2 300-gallon tanks or 1 300-gallon tank, those big white plastic jugs that you'll usually see for like fire suppression. You can use those exact same setup for potable water supply. So with these storage tanks, basically what you're doing is you're letting that low yielding well just slowly fill up those tanks over the course of an entire day versus having to rely on the well itself having the surplus as well as the discharge rate. So basically you put these big tanks in the basement, the well fills it up over the course of time, and you're gonna put another pump at that tank to repressurize the piping or the water throughout the home. The tricky part with this is though, that you're gonna have to make sure you get some kind of water treatment to disinfect that water, and you're gonna have a little bit more maintenance as well as mechanical costs, right? The more moving pieces you have, the more expensive things get, the more maintenance you have to put into it, and the more complicated the system is, right? Most homeowners can do most of the work and the mitigation and water treatment themselves, but once you start getting into this extra storage tank, it starts to get a little bit beyond what most homeowners are comfortable or capable of doing. Now, I have faith in you because I know that you're here to learn. So we're gonna talk a little bit, right? So storage tanks are a good solution, but not a permanent solution. And the reason why is when we test properties for property transfer, it doesn't matter what your reserve is. It only matters what the yield of the well is. So if you have a contract, most contracts in our state require 1.0, but you can change the contract and have it say whatever you want. If your contract is from the buyer saying they want a 3 gallon per minute well, and your well can only produce 0.7, then you're out of contract, right? If you're only able to produce 0.7, you're still in trouble because you're not able to hit that one, and that creates some problems. And that leads us to our second option. The second option to deal with a bad well is hydrofracking. Now, hydrofracking, the best way to kind of think about this is it's kind of like you're pressure washing the inside of the well, right? You're putting a high pressure jet of water and it blows open all the fractures, cleans out all the junk, all the debris, and it helps to rejuvenate some of the well. Now, usually in our area, we'll see that a hydrofracked well will usually increase your water supply by about a half a gallon, maybe a gallon, depending on your soil condition or your geology, your rock formations, how deep the well is, the experience of that hydrofracker. It's not a super common thing in our area. People do it. It's just most people don't trust it, in my opinion. Because whenever I bring that option up, they're just like, well, no, we'd rather just go for a new well. Which is your third option. The third most dramatic option is to drill a new well, right? That is a fairly expensive process. In our area, usually you can see drilled wells cost anywhere from $25 to $35 per foot, and you're paying per hole, right? So let's just say you drill a 300 foot hole and you don't hit water, guess what? You just paid a lot of money for a empty hole, and then you have to start over. So when you're drilling a new well, the requirements, at least in our state, is in 2 hours, you must produce 500 gallons of water, and over the course of 6 hours, you must produce at least 1 gallon per minute. Now, you already have an existing well on the property. So in our state, you're allowed to get away with a little bit less, because usually if you have a low yielding well, that means that that area is not gonna be able to support a well as efficiently, right? I've had properties where the records will indicate that they've drilled 7 dry holes and they barely have any water. So as long as you can hit 0.5 between both wells, what you can do is you can piggyback off of one another. You just have both wells in service, both wells have pumps, pressure switches, etc., and then you switch between the two, and that'll make it to where you can get your 1.0. That's a more complicated way of doing things. I don't usually see that super often around here. You'll see that kind of near Fort Detrick. You'll see that some parts of like Moncton, up 83 in Baltimore County area. It's not a super common issue, but it is something that can happen. So if you have two wells that are at least 0.5 that'll hit you with your 1.0, you just bounce between the two, and that's usually the most efficient way, or the best way really, to permanently solve your issue. So if you have a low yielding well, I know you probably don't want to hear this, but my opinion is it's time to consider drilling a new well. Again, you do have two other options, such as extra storage, which again does not solve your problem. It just kind of makes it to where you can function until you can either get the funding or the ability to drill a new well. The second option is to hydrofrack. Your area may have a little bit more patience and tolerance with it, but at least in our area, most people don't seem to want to do it. But that is an option. It does work. I have seen hydrofracking work. I have seen it bring wells back to life. You just have to find a well driller who knows what they're doing and can do it, right? If you gained any value out of this, if you found this informative in any way, please hit that like button, hit subscribe. I have videos posted every day on the World of Well and Septic, and I hope that I was able to give you some information that could help you in your situation. If you're going through a low yielding well situation right now, leave a comment below. Share your story, tell it, so that way somebody else maybe can go through their process and have your experience to help them figure out what they want to do, right? I look forward to talking to you guys tomorrow, and I'll see you soon.